Two explosive teams. That's what we have here.
That whole entire series was a war.
Oh, what a save! Mano a mano.
The rivalry type games are so intense. As a player, you look forward to those games.
Oh, baby! What a finish!
The Battle of Alberta was something that everybody got into.
It was pure hatred. At its peak, I don't think there was one that could rival it.
Welcome to NHL Network's countdown of the top rivalries of the 1990s. I'm Tony Luffman. For every fan, for every player, it's the dates you circle on your calendar each year. It's the games you look forward to each season. It's the rivalry games. And in the 90s, rivalries were taken to new levels. From the original six feuds reignited to the ones born in the decade, we kick things off at number 10.
There are so many different factors that really go into what can really make a rivalry great. But more often than not, you ask the players about the rivalry and they'll tell you it's what's going on in the stands. It's the fans of those two teams that really foster the passion for the rivalry.
The intensity of it, it spills into the stands, and it's just a natural continuation onto the ice.
And this has been festering almost since the national anthem.
Montreal has the greater history. This was really ultra-field rivalry.
The skyline of Buffalo, Western New York awaits game one of an Adams Division showdown between the Sabres and Canadiens.
They're not booing us, they're booing the Canadiens are coming on the ice.
This is shaping up as a battle of two great goaltenders between the Canadiens' Patrick Roy and Darren Pupa.
I have never considered this one of the noisier buildings in the National Hockey League. I may change my verdict on that after tonight. Should be a lot of fun as the Canadiens and the Sabres get together.
The feud between these division rivals erupted in the 90s, matching up four times in the playoffs, meeting for the first time during the 1990 division semifinal. The team split the first two games and sent game three into overtime.
Forston behind the net, Skoglund, they score! Is there anything in hockey to match the home team scoring in overtime?
This series is far from over. A tremendously big win, though, for Montreal tonight.
The Sabres tied the series up with a win in Game 4, but the Habs would not be stopped and took Games 5 and 6 to advance.
This one is done. Canadiens win it. Buffalo had a great season. It's all for naught. They were up against a very determined Montreal Canadiens team tonight, who will now advance. Sport is cruel. One has to lose. This time, it's the Sabres.
Like a carbon copy of the previous year, the Habs and Sabres met again in the semis with an overtime squeaker and a Canadiens victory in six.
Cardinal coming in! Cardinal is in! He scores! Cardinal! Canadiens win the game! And at 5:56 of overtime, the Canadiens win the game and take a 3-2 lead in the series. It's over. Sabres again are eliminated in the first round by the Montreal Canadiens.
And the stage is set for game one of the Adams final. The Canadiens and the Sabres.
The Canadiens continued their reign of terror over the Sabres in 1993.
Here's a loose puck, Savard to Carpenter. They score! Sabres are stunned, and the Canadiens take a stranglehold on the series. They lead 3-0.
For the third time in 4 years, it was the Canadiens on top with a sweep of the Sabres en route to a Stanley Cup.
And now a 24th Stanley Cup banner will hang from the rafters of the famous Forum in Montreal. The Canadiens win the Stanley Cup.
Five years later, the Sabres got some sweet revenge on the Habs during their final matchup of the decade in the Eastern Conference semifinal.
Sabres have not been beyond the second round of the playoffs since 1980. They'll try to get there in this Eastern Conference semifinal against Montreal.
Days later, the Sabres completed the sweep for their first playoff series win over Montreal since 1983.
That's it. Buffalo, beast of the East as they advance to the Eastern Conference Final. A series sweep of Montreal.
Dallas, Detroit.
You could tell there was a genuine hatred between both organizations.
They will each get five for fighting, and they deserve it.
I always enjoyed those. So much skill on those Detroit teams back then. And then Dallas, they had to counterpunch, bringing in guys like Brett Hull, Joe Newendike, Darian, the Beast Hatcher. He was tremendous. And how about Sergei Zubov? Tremendous rivalries.
This contentious battle began during the 1992 playoffs, a year before the Stars relocated from Minnesota to Dallas. In Game 6 of the Norris Division semifinal, Sergei Fedorov scored a controversial overtime winner.
Sergei Fedorov has the puck. Tenorti's caught up ice. Fedorov heading for the net. With the puck, hit the crossbar. Flipped it up and hit the crossbar. Unbelievable.
Oh, they're going to review this play. Wouldn't it be something if a review led to a winning goal in overtime?
This was the first time video replay was used in the Stanley Cup playoffs.
And now the Red Wings fly off the bench, and mayhem ensues. And the video replay has given the Red Wings a new life in this series. How about that?
The Red Wings went on to win Game 7 and eliminate the North Stars from the playoffs. 3 years later, the new-look Dallas Stars got a chance for retribution when they met Detroit in the Western Conference quarterfinal.
The Detroit Red Wings won the President's Trophy as the number one team in the National Hockey League this season. They swept the season series with the Dallas Stars, but most of the games were very close. The Octopus has been thrown on the ice, and that means they're ready.
Things got off to a rocky and physical start between the two teams. It was clear that the bad blood between these two was just beginning to boil.
Flat all over Fedorov, and I mean all over him.
And just like their last meeting, the Detroit Red Wings walked away with the series win.
That will do it. And the Red Wings, with a big monkey off the back, they win in the first round. And the Red Wings take this series 4-1.
In 1997, the Red Wings raised the Stanley Cup for the first time in 42 years.
Not since Gordie Howe, Ted Lindsay, and Terry Sawchuk 42 years ago has there been the opportunity to hoist the cup. It's my pleasure to present the Stanley Cup to Steve Yzerman.
As the newly crowned champs, the Red Wings had targets on their backs, leading to some early season dust-ups with some old rivals.
Oh, man.
When Yzerman is slammed into the end boards, and McCarty takes revenge on that. Darren McCarty did what he had to do.
Yzerman still down.
Hatcher chased him to the corner and drilled him up on the wall.
Hatcher's been cut.
Hatcher's cut over the eye. That's what he's upset about.
No place for a nervous person in this game, boy.
Looking to defend their championship, the Detroit Red Wings would have to first get by the Dallas Stars in the 1998 Western Conference Final.
Wonderful matchup. Western Conference Final Game 1, best of 7. The winner of last year's playoffs, the Detroit Red Wings. The winner of this year's season, the Dallas Stars.
And just like their regular season contests, these enemies wasted no time picking things up right where they left off.
Oh, boy. This is about the way we thought it would start.
I mean, we're giving them too much respect, and we can't do that.
The tension between the Wings and Stars was palpable, but the reigning champs would not back down. And like every other matchup between these teams in the decade, the Red Wings were triumphant.
Shoots up! The Dallas Stars! The Detroit Red Wings!
Detroit was in cruise control and sailed by the Caps for their second consecutive championship.
The Detroit Red Wings have won the Stanley Cup for the second year in a row.
The 1998 playoffs was the last meeting for the Wings and Stars in the 90s. And although the Red Wings were the victors in each of their postseason showdowns, the Stars capped off the end of the decade with some cup lifting of their own. Still to come, we continue counting down the top rivalries of the 1990s with a provincial war. Find out where these Canadian competitors rank after the break. Welcome back to the top rivalries of the 1990s. Before there was Sid and Ovi, the Pens and Caps had a long-standing dislike for one another. Meeting frequently in the regular season and the playoffs, these East Coast rivals thrived in the 90s, and they get us back into our countdown at number 8.
The distaste for the team.
This is a great war. It is a great rivalry being continued here in this playoff series.
Players.
Well, this is definitely a rivalry rekindled.
The city from fan to fan, it's as strong as anything we get.
This feud between Pittsburgh and Washington kicked off during the 1991 Patrick Division Final, the first ever playoff matchup between the two clubs.
When the Capitals in the early 90s met the Penguins, they truly felt that they could have been a Stanley Cup level team.
Back to Francis, back in front. LeMieux shoots a save by Beaupre.
They had some dynamic players, some real strong players, and were a real good team unit. But they weren't Mario Lemieux, and they weren't the Pittsburgh Penguins.
I used to always watch how Mario would just vamp it up that game.
And that one tucked in very neatly by Mario Lemieux.
Wow, where's he getting this extra intensity from? Like, he really wants to beat this team.
The Penguins downed the Capitals in 5 games on their way to the team's first Stanley Cup. These two foes would meet again in the playoffs the following year.
The Caps were much better in this series early on.
Although the Caps took a 3-1 series lead, the defending champs would not be turned away.
Jágr walks in, scores! A great individual effort by Jágr.
Hard-fought series. Both teams played extremely well.
Put the defense, finds Hunter, scores! On the left wing, Lemieux fires a shot, scores!
We were down a few times in those series. To kind of overcome that and find a way to win was really kind of fun.
The Penguins pushed the series to Game 7 and defeated the Capitals to advance to another Stanley Cup berth. In 1994, Washington met their rivals once again in the postseason.
Murmurs start about where teams are going to end up and who's going to play whom, particularly in the first round. And there were a number of guys in our locker room that wanted nothing to do with Pittsburgh. Mario was at the height of it. Jágr was at the height of it. I had a totally different viewpoint. I didn't really care. You know, it was my first year in Washington.
Mario Lemieux. Oh, he got leveled by Dave Poulin, and the fans love that.
The way that the Caps shut down Mario Lemieux, and Dave Poulin was a big part of it.
They end up keeping the Penguins to just 12 goals in 6 games.
Open, Mario shot. Oh, what a save! Don Beaupre, mano a mano.
The Caps win that series. Don Beaupre, outstanding in net, and they go on, they advance in the playoffs.
This one is over. The Capitals have defeated the Pittsburgh Penguins 6-3.
It was deja vu for these rivals in 1995 when the Caps took another 3-1 series lead. But just like the 92 playoffs, the Pens stormed back.
Stevens in front, Francis scores! The Pittsburgh Penguins win it to the Capitals, squandering a 3-1 lead in this series.
A year later, the clubs met in the playoffs for a third consecutive season.
It's a series that has a game 4. It ends up going 4 overtime.
Here's Nedved. Tenorti went down again. Nedved score! It's over! Peter Nedved! Penguins win in the 4th overtime.
Game 5 on the bench.
assistant coach Brian Trottier of the Pittsburgh Penguins, and Jim Schoenfeld of the Washington Capitals, start yapping at each other.
They had Tenorti on defense, and he just had a good scrap with one of our tough guys.
Right on the draw, some more scores to be settled.
And Jimmy was saying, oh yeah, well we just beat your tough guy. He's saying this over the boards. And I'm saying to him, it doesn't matter. We're gonna win the game.
Trottier and Schoenfeld are like this, right next to each other.
With all intensity, I can remember saying, but we're gonna win the series. And he's going, yeah, but we're gonna win the fights. I said, doesn't matter, we're gonna win this game.
It happens once in a while where the coaches are yelling at each other, whatever, but this was super intense. So you knew what this rivalry meant between these two teams.
After losing the first two games on home ice, the Pittsburgh Penguins win four straight.
Pittsburgh's thrilling finish was the final playoff clash for both teams in the decade.
If you're a Washington Capitals fan, the Penguin logo is just like something that you lose sleep at night when you see it. They just seem to always find a way to beat them.
It's not just hockey. It's city versus city.
He takes the shot.
They battle over a lot of different things, sports, politics, business.
When you speak to somebody in Calgary and you say, you know, I grew up in Edmonton, there's always that slight pause.
Same province, not too far apart. There's still bitterness in Calgary that Edmonton is the provincial capital. There's still bitterness in Edmonton that Calgary won that Stanley Cup.
Edmontonians think that they are superior to the Calgarians and vice versa.
The Battle of Alberta took rivalries to new heights in the 1980s, meeting four times in the playoffs during this era and taking home five of the decade's Stanley Cups. This provincial conflict boiled over into the 90s. The Edmonton Oilers drew first blood, winning the Stanley Cup in 1990, their fifth in 7 years.
The Edmonton Oilers, Stanley Cup champions, 1990.
The following season, they met their bitter rivals and played in their most brutal matchup to date.
That whole entire series was a war.
And there's some hard feelings after that whistle blew.
You see those guys around, Mess or whoever, and you have a little smile because you kind of know what you went through.
Edmonton took a commanding 3-1 series lead as tensions continued to mount.
All 46 guys that played in the series, we all should be in jail because of some of the stuff we did.
Calgary won game 5 at home.
Messier gets it away.
And game 6 in overtime.
Hockey's version of high noon at the Olympic Saddle Dome in Calgary. The Flames and the Oilers, it's game 7.
Here's Reichel, that shot block. Rebound, scores! Here's Suter, to do it, scores! And then again, Fleury, scores! A 3-goal lead, and it's now 2. And the Oilers have some hope. Here's the shot, they score! He waits to set it up, shoot, scores!
Four unanswered goals of the Calgary Flames. Wondering what happened.
The Flames running out of time and come up with a tying goal.
The battle of Alberta's fiercest series appropriately headed to overtime for the second straight game.
3 points in the game, a couple of goals for Esa-Tikkanen, 6 in the series. Shoot, scores! Esa-Tikkanen has won it for the Oilers.
When you're watching, you see the effort that Esa-Tikkanen makes, and he puts the quick shot on net using the D-man as a screen right there. It was pretty impressive.
There's no doubt that we have an excellent series, and Calgary played excellent, was tough series, and too bad one team has to lost.
It used to be division play that led to a lot of the rivalries, and certainly when you talk about the Smythe division, you know, you had Calgary and Edmonton, they had to meet every year in the playoffs. And, you know, when one team ends up with a little bit of an upper hand, it just grows. It grows not just the rivalry, but there's that, I got to beat that team. And I think that drove Calgary. And then when Calgary beat Edmonton, it drove Edmonton even further to say, we can't let these guys get an upper hand on us. And it's just gone on from there.
I would like to think that that rivalry is near in the top three anyhow, because as a player, having played 20 years in the National Hockey League, I never really experienced anything like that. The Battle of Alberta was something that everybody got into.
Coming up next, our countdown rolls on with a clash between the great one and the next one. Where will these Hall of Famers land on our countdown? Find out after the break. Welcome back to the top rivalries of the 1990s. New York and Philadelphia have always had a contentious relationship. But when you pit the greatest player to ever lace up his skates against one of the most highly touted prospects of all time, it makes for an unbelievable showdown. Time now to dive right back into our countdown with Broadway versus Broad Street at number six.
It's like a performer on the stage. You know, you have a good crowd, you're going to perform better.
Really getting in those two arenas, they're different, but the fans are just as intense.
As a younger guy going into Philly, that was probably the most intimidating building that I had ever been in.
You were in the middle of a washing machine. That place was just very, very intense.
Madison Square Garden is a one-of-a-kind place.
So anytime you played against the Rangers, especially if you're playing at MSG, you want to try to put on a show.
When you have 17,000 people backing you up, every shot, every hit, every moment, that becomes very powerful.
In 1995, a young and hungry Flyers team looked to dethrone the veteran Rangers, fresh off their first cup in 54 years.
Philadelphia's got incredible sports fans. Every game seemed to be a war.
The team that knocked the defending champion Rangers out of the playoffs in 1995 was the Philadelphia Flyers.
Flyers pretty much dominated that series.
Two explosive teams, that's what we have here in this series.
Lindros making his presence felt early. 237 pounds on the end of a cross check. You have no alternative but to go down.
They were gonna work very, very hard, make you earn your win, and if they were gonna lose the game, they were gonna take a strip of flesh from you while they did it.
Racing over center, he's coming in. A pass back, Holler.
Taking a 3-0 lead, including back-to-back games decided in overtime, the Flyers finished off the 95 conference semifinal with a sweep of the Rangers.
The New York Rangers are former champions. The Philadelphia Flyers have gone to the Eastern Conference Finals.
Two years later, the Rangers and Flyers met again in the playoffs, and a star-studded duo was reunited.
97 was a terrific series. That was the one year that we got to watch Wayne Gretzky and Mark Messier play together as Rangers in the Stanley Cup playoffs.
Messier shoots, he scores! Rebound, Richter, that was upside! Gretzky near side, scores!
After defeating Florida and upsetting New Jersey, the Rangers clashed with Philly.
Eric Lindros against Mark Messier, and people remember kind of Lindros kind of shrugging off Messier to score an empty net goal.
Lindros, and he's got a hat trick! And he battled through Mark Messier. Eric Lindros with an empty net goal. A hat trick for him, his first ever in the playoffs.
He may be the only player in this game who cannot be stopped when he puts his mind to wanting something. And boy, did Eric Lindros want this puck.
They had physically taken it to us. We were a little tired going into that series and a lot tired coming out of it.
The Philadelphia Flyers have defeated the Rangers and will go on to play for the Stanley Cup.
This is one heck of a hockey club that's going to represent the East.
Whacks and slashes and clutches, and now it dissolves into handshakes.
97 was one that some Ranger fans would say so stunned that franchise that they didn't make the playoffs for another 8 years after that.
Sometimes people look at a rivalry and they think it can only be a rivalry that's established over time, like an original six rivalry. But sometimes it's the villains, you know, it's the personalities, it's the cities, it's some of the characters, some of the fans, some of the traditions, all those things I think go into making a great rivalry.
We'd had a great rivalry in Dallas with the Edmonton Oilers and a team that really pushed and made you a better team.
Intensity, the rivalry type games are so intense. As a player, you look forward to those games.
You talk about what really makes it, I think it's that intense rival in the playoffs.
The feud between Dallas and Edmonton was almost an overnight sensation. Although this grudge didn't peak until the latter half of the 90s, the teams put on a show every time they met, beginning in the 1997 Western Conference quarterfinal.
Opening night of the Stanley Cup playoffs, we're en route to Dallas, Texas for our feature game this evening. The once mighty Edmonton Oilers are back in the hunt and headed for a doozy first round test in the Lone Star State.
The Stanley Cup playoffs are underway here in the heart of Texas. We've got Edmonton and Dallas.
The intensity between these two teams quickly escalated.
Pavlov is dumped. Penalty coming up against Dallas.
Following two electrifying overtime wins by Edmonton in games 3 and 5, the series would be decided in a seventh and final game. Again, Edmonton would win in OT with some help from their man in net.
Up here, these two teams. For Dallas, a chance at revenge. The Oilers, a chance to do it again.
The Game 7 loss to the Oilers 1 year prior was a bitter pill for the Stars to swallow. So when they got the opportunity to face them in the 1998 Western Conference semis, they weren't holding anything back.
Knockout score! The Stars get it done in overtime. It's Benoit Hogue, and Dallas wins 1-0. They take the series lead 2-1.
Oilers keep it in, but that's it. The Dallas Stars are halfway home.
They wanted them. They got them.
A little more than 12 months later, finally, for these fans in Texas,
hard-fought victory here to do away with Edmonton and move on to the conference final.
Falling just short of reaching the Stanley Cup Final in 1998, the Stars returned to the playoffs in 99 with their eyes on the prize. But before they could hoist Lord Stanley, they would have to meet some familiar faces in the first round. With a dominant 3-0 lead, Dallas secured the sweep of their rivals after going to triple overtime.
Bounces off the leg. Here's Zubov with the shot. He scores! And it's a series sweep for the Dallas Stars, but they have to work for every bit of it.
Dallas would move on to face the Blues and the Avs before they would reach the final, where the Golden Brett would secure the cup in dramatic fashion.
Rebound, score! Brett Hull rammed it home. Cup has been won. Dallas Stars are the Stanley Cup champions.
After the break, we continue counting down the top rivalries of the 1990s, featuring an original six confrontation. How will this legendary rivalry stack up on our countdown? Find out next.
Avalanche have won the Stanley Cup!
Unbelievable!
A three and cut through!
They score! The Los Angeles Kings!
Yes, love you.
The Rangers are the champions!
The only thing that's important is the Stanley Cup.
Welcome back to our countdown of the top rivalries of the 1990s. In the Midwest, nothing compares to the bad blood between Chicago and St. Louis. These two cities have a long history of conflict, but it is what happened when they met in the 90s that makes our countdown and gets us back at number 4.
More than anything, it's usually the geography that usually sets the tone for where the rivalry is going to go.
St. Louis, Chicago is a pretty big rivalry.
There's no doubt there's hatred between these two teams. I don't think anyone's forgetting about the history we've had in the playoffs.
It's always been amazing, whether it's in our arena or your arena. I mean, it's a great rivalry.
Given the matchup, that's only going to intensify the game.
We always came to St. Louis knowing that we were in for a great game.
Separated by 300 miles, these two divisional foes turned up the heat on their rivalry during the 90s. Kicking off the decade, the two played a hard-fought seven-game series packed with big hits, big fights, and big scores.
And it's all over. Dwayne Sutter getting the final goal for Chicago in a lopsided 8-2 Chicago Blackhawk victory over the St. Louis Blues.
Emotions from the 90 playoffs carried over into the next season, where this rivalry exploded on the ice.
Oh, what a night we are in for. Manson having words with Stevens. Oh, it's Scott Stevens hot. There are 2, 4, 6, 8. Well, there are a few extra Chicago players. If a brawl starts here, Chicago's got a 2-1 advantage.
When we had the big brawl, Chase and Twist, they were out of control.
Stevens wants one man, and that's Manson. We're going to have a brawl, folks. Stand by. There's no question about it here. And this is as wild as we have seen in the NHL in a number of years.
Every game that we went and played, whether it was here in St. Louis or in Chicago Stadium, it was electric.
This is a mess.
The Hawks and the Blues continued their physical feud in the playoffs in 1992, with Chicago coming out on top once again. In 1993, the Blues struck back big with a four-game sweep of the Blackhawks in the division semis, including an overtime winner to close out the series.
Blues in the midst of a change. Big hit by Lowry. Hawks fed back off and Janney. Quick one in front. Score! And the Blues have eliminated the Chicago Blackhawks in a spectacular hockey game. And are they happy here in St. Louis?
1993 marked the last playoff matchup for these teams in the 90s. But this decade's rough and tumble rivalry spawned a disdain for generations to come.
Definitely adds to it that there's some bad blood and then rivalry between the two teams.
They're a little extra special, obviously. Nice little rivalry that's grown. You know, obviously there's a lot of history, but I think over the last few seasons it's gotten a lot more intense.
The most important factor of a rivalry is something that triggers it, whether it's history with two original six franchises that have battled epically for years.
The rivalry between Montreal and Boston is a little bit different. It's a little bit more edgy.
It's definitely the biggest rivalry that I've been a part of at any level of sports.
We play Saturday against Montreal, and then Sunday back at home against the Canadiens, and a lot of grudges carried over to the next day.
Everybody hated Boston. Everybody on the team.
In Boston, you grow up and you're taught to hate the Habs.
The Bruins and the Canadiens have met in the playoffs more times than any teams in history, spanning generations. Their clashes have created one of the greatest rivalries in all of sports.
Based on regular season standing, the top two teams in the NHL still alive now collide as for the seventh year in a row, the Bruins and the Canadiens meet in the Stanley Cup playoffs.
The Bees and the Habs closed out the millennium with their rivalry stronger than ever, adding fuel to an already raging fire. These time-tested adversaries battled it out in the 1990 Adams Division Final.
And what would springtime in New England be like? I wonder, without the Bruins and the Canadiens in a Stanley Cup playoff.
The Bruins took a quick 2-0 series lead with a thrilling Game 2 overtime winner.
Bruins galley side of the net. The Bruins come in there, score! Boston wins! The Bruins win it in overtime here at the Boston Garden.
The intensity of that series, I think Boston really galvanized themselves as a team during that series. I think they really came together in that series.
And here's the siren. Boston wins the series. 4-1.
Arch enemies, but both coaching staffs congratulating each other on a bitterly fought series won by the Boston Bruins.
The following year, the teams would face off again in the Adams Division Final, with the series going a nail-biting 7 games.
Two sure signs of spring in Boston, the marathon which ran Monday, and a playoff series between the Bruins and Canadiens. They meet in the playoffs for the 26th time. The Bruins have had a lot of success of late, winning 2 of the last 3, including last year's final, in 5 games over the Canadiens.
Of course.
Shot goes! Carson scores! Canadians win!
Oh, baby! What a finish! Well, this sellout crowd got their money's worth tonight at the Forum, seeing the Canadians send the series to a seventh game Monday in Boston. It is now over! Boston has won it! 2-1!
But it was the Boston Bruins and all their role players, along with their stars, that made the difference here in Game 7.
For the third straight year, these two teams battled in the division final. But it would only take the Bruins four games to eliminate their rival.
It's over, folks. The Bruins in a sweep. Home in a shutout. The Canadians are gone, and the Bruins move on.
After suffering back-to-back playoff losses to the Bruins, the Canadiens answered back in 1993, capturing the 24th championship in franchise history.
And now a 24th Stanley Cup banner will hang from the rafters of the famous Forum in Montreal. The Canadiens win the Stanley Cup!
Hoping for a repeat of Stanley Cup glory in 1994, the Habs had to get by their old foes in the first round of the playoffs.
It's the 28th time the Canadians and the Bruins have met. A great collision between the Bees and the Habs.
Saturday night, Boston, Montreal, the Stanley Cup playoffs. The tradition continues. The 133rd playoff meeting between these two teams underway.
The series went the distance, and for the third time in the decade, the Bruins got the last laugh and edged out the Habs to advance in the playoffs.
We'll let the Bruin fans take this one down. Boston moves on, and there will be a new Stanley Cup champion in 1994.
1994 was the last time these teams would meet in the playoffs during the decade. Although the Canadiens have bested the Bruins in all-time play, Boston dominated Montreal in the 90s to even the playing field for this storied rivalry.
These fans have that bitter taste, that, you know, that hatred. And again, it's all respect, but that hatred for the Habs and anything Montreal.
That's what we want to be a part of. That's what makes things exciting. The passion for both cities and the hate for each other.
Year in, year out, just, regardless of who won the series, it was just great hockey and physical and intense, and both teams with a great tradition, and that's what makes a rivalry.
Eight down, two to go on our countdown of the top rivalries of the 1990s. Which two rivalries were bigger and badder than the rest? Stick around to find out. Welcome back to the top rivalries of the 1990s. Let's take a look back at the duels that have made our list so far.
And this has been festering almost since the national anthem.
Montreal has the greater history. This was really ultra, ultra field rivalry.
You could tell there was a genuine hatred between both organizations.
They will each get five for fighting, and they deserve it. This is a great war. It is a great rivalry being continued here in this playoff series.
It's not just hockey. It's city versus city.
And there's some hard feelings after that whistle blew.
Two explosive teams. That's what we have here in this series.
You talk about what really makes it. I think it's that intense rival in the playoffs. We'd had a great rivalry in Dallas with the Edmonton Oilers.
More than anything, it's usually the geography that usually sets the tone for where the rivalry is going to go.
There's no doubt there's hatred between these two teams. I don't think anyone's forgetting about the history we've had in the playoffs.
The rivalry between Montreal and Boston is a little bit different. It's a little bit edgy.
Let's wrap up our countdown with the top two rivalries of the 1990s.
Okay, the Rangers get all the press. The Rangers are the Rangers. Original six, all the history. Madison Square Garden. We got to try to beat these guys. We got to raise our game to try to beat these guys.
In 1982, the Colorado Rockies relocated to New Jersey and became the Devils. After the move, the Devils were required to pay territorial indemnities to the Rangers, Flyers, and Islanders in order to play in New Jersey, almost instantly creating regional rivalries.
Let's talk fans. You got to understand, there's generations of fans. You could have three, four generations of Ranger fans, two, three generations of Devils fans. But why I say cross-pollination is so many people live all over the place. So you may have grown up a New Yorker in the city. Maybe you moved to Jersey. Who knows? So maybe your son or your daughter, your kids, maybe they grew up being fans of that team. but maybe grandma and mom and dad may have been fans of the Rangers, let's say. So it's an interesting mix.
The Rangers and the Devils met for the first time in the postseason in 1992, where the Rangers bested their bordering neighbors in seven.
This could get very nasty. Jay Lemieux cut him off in front. Stastny scores! Breathing room for the Devils. 5-3 New Jersey. Boy, you just don't see this often in the NHL anymore. Bench clearing balls. It's getting very ugly now. An ugly, ugly scene mars what has been a great series. The Devils, however, have won the game. 5-3, forcing a seventh and deciding game in this Patrick Division semifinal.
Turcotte breaking away, all alone for the Rangers.
First goal of a hockey game is always a big game, but I think that this is probably one of the biggest goals you can get in playoff hockey. It's in the seventh game, and you're at home.
Nastasny, Nemchinov's back on the ice. The shot from the point, they score! And it's 1-1. Graves is in the slot. Patrick has the puck. Side of the net, Amani shoots, hit the post. They score on the rebound. It's all the way to center. The Rangers are 2-on-1. Graves with Messier. 4-1 Rangers. Here's a bouncing puck in an open net. Mark Messier, it's over now. It was a great series.
2 years later, the teams would meet again in the playoffs, and again, the Rangers would knock the Devils out in seven on their way to a Stanley Cup.
Well, this is what everyone in hockey waits for, a seventh and deciding game to get to the Stanley Cup final. This is so big for each of those teams. The Devils' story is this. They have never been to the Stanley Cup final before. They want a chance to get there, and they want a chance to build a loyal fan base. And the New York Rangers have been in this league for so long, and they have won so few Stanley Cups. Tonight, they have a chance to get to their first Stanley Cup since 1979. They haven't won one since 1940. It's been 54 years.
Matteau swoops in to intercept. Matteau behind the net. Swings it in front. He scores! Matteau! 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 Defend Matteau! And the Rangers have one more hell to climb, baby! The Rangers are headed to the final!
And the chant is, we want the cup.
This is the moment they have waited for a lifetime. The waiting is over! The New York Rangers are the Stanley Cup champions! And this one will last a lifetime!
No more curses! This is unbelievable!
The following season, the Devils swept the Red Wings for their first Stanley Cup in franchise history.
How solid is this team, you ask? They're fit, they're tough, they're talented. They all have the right stuff now, because now
this rivalry's been going on for a long time. It can simmer, they can feud. It's the Devils and the Rangers.
Devils and the New York Rangers. It's been fun.
All right, you guys have seen the countdown so far. So what is the best rivalry of the 90s for you?
Take it away, Panger. Come on.
It's the Red Wings and the Colorado Avalanche. I mean, rivalries are built on ugly moments, on battles, on scraps, on fights, on playoff series, on world-class players, Yzerman versus Sakic. You had Forsberg, you had Lidstrom. I mean, it was all there. It was right there. And I remember one game in particular I did nationally, and it was the second year. The second year. I never thought it was going to happen again. You had the year before, it was Vernon versus Patrick Waugh. It was at center ice. I'm doing the game the next year, and it's, here comes Chris Osgood and Patrick Waugh, and I wholly jumping myself. I was so excited to be a part of that and just watching it all. Just, to me, it was the greatest rivalry that I've experienced as a broadcaster, for sure.
Yeah, that's hard to argue. I just think the intensity of it, and the contrast between skill, superstar skill, and intensity on both sides.
And hate?
And hate. Mm. And the hatred. And the play on Chris Draper. I mean, we can go on and on. The goalie fights, as you talked about. But also, that was just a white-hot intensity, a burning intensity between both teams anytime they matched up. Those were a lot of fun to watch.
It was combustible. And, you know, it's a good rivalry when you get 19 holy jumps.
Yeah, exactly.
We had the good, the bad, the ugly, all in the best way possible.
This whole rivalry really begins with one hit.
Detroit and Colorado, it was personal.
I didn't see them doing that in our bar. They waited till they got home.
Well, it's either started something new or ended something old.
This was a blood rivalry.
It was pure hatred. At its peak, I don't think there was one that could rival it.
I think it was important that the NHL got a rivalry of a non-traditional team.
Puck in front, score!
Really a rivalry that was forged by competition. It wasn't a geographical rivalry, but it was two teams that were just really good teams with great players, with multiple Hall of Famers.
The amount of talent on the ice when those two teams would play each other, maybe unparalleled. Joe Sakic and Patrick Waugh and Peter Forsberg, I mean, those three guys alone, you can't lose with those three guys on your team.
What made it so good was the matchup of quality on both sides.
In 1996, during Game 6 of the Western Conference Final, the NHL's newest rivalry was officially born.
Well, I was on the bench. I was actually going to change Chris Draper.
Coffey banged it back the other way to Draper. Waiting for his teammates to clear. Draper's hurt. He got leveled by Claude Lemieux, and he is down on the ice.
The seminal picture is of Lemieux's hit on Draper.
Obviously, it was a vicious hit, and I never see it in my life like that.
Claude Lemieux has picked up a 5-minute major, and the Avalanche have lost Lemieux for the remainder of this game.
You remember the line after the series? I think it was Dino Ciccarelli.
I can't believe I shook this guy's freaking hand after the game.
I subsequently talked to Claude Lemieux, did stories on him, and, you know, he looks at it one way, and the Red Wings look at it another way.
A lot of Red Wings to this day will tell you, you know, that was a moment. It was a defining moment for our team.
They really took this thing from this level to this level.
The Avalanche have won the Stanley Cup, and dreams do come true.
Adding insult to injury, Colorado went on to win the first championship in franchise history.
Well, they talk about the perfect storm. This was the perfect storm on ice.
Detroit had to stand up for themselves.
Everybody said Detroit is a good team, but not tough enough.
The mayhem was just beginning, as every game between the two rivals became a spectacle.
You get to the rink and you feel the excitement right away. It's so easy to get pumped for the game.
These teams, when they were on TV, they were really must-see TV.
Now he wants to go with Osgood. Here we go again.
You would be playing your game, and then you would almost check the TV later and see just what happened in that game.
You didn't want to go into the kitchen and get a soda because you might miss the defining moment of that game.
Between 1996 and 1999, the Red Wings and the Avs would meet in the playoffs three times.
Detroit, the Western Conference champions.
Every year we play each other, we know that one of the team will have a good run in the playoffs.
Together, they would account for three of the four Stanley Cups won in that era.
Not only was there all of the history and all of the underlying elements of it, but it was the fact that you knew when you were watching that series that pretty much the winner of that series was going to win the Stanley Cup.
There was no feud fiercer than Colorado and Detroit during the 90s, built on passion, hatred, and most importantly, Stanley Cups. These two teams exemplified what it means to be a rivalry. For NHL Network, I'm Tony Loveman. We'll see you next time.